Society. My name is Philip Davies. I work for Dame Space and I'm also the chairman of the Space Group here at the Society. So this lecture, as well as the audience in here tonight, the lecture is also being streamed via the Aero Society YouTube channel. So welcome to anyone who happens to be listening in over the internet. Just a few housekeeping statements before we start. So there currently is no plan to have a test of the fire alarm system. So if the alarm goes, then we need to get out of the building. So there are doors marked at the front and rear of the room. And the designated meeting point is at the corner of Piccadilly and Hamilton Place. Just a reminder not to leave any unmarked bags lying around the building. The building has a no smoking policy, so please no smoking in the building. If any of you have mobile phones, then we would greatly appreciate if you could either switch them off or put them into a silent mode. And we do politely request that you don't use them during the event, other than interacting with things like Twitter if you want to tweet things. And there's a society account called RAS Events, if you could tag that, if you do send anything out on Twitter. Before we get to the talk, there is another piece of business tonight. So I'd like to introduce Dr. McSteeden, Chairman of the Medals and Awards Committee, and he's here tonight to present an award on behalf of the Society.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It's my very great privilege to present to you this evening on behalf of the President and the Council of the Royal Aeronautical Society, the winner of the Geoffrey Pardo Space Award for 2014. But first, it gives me very great pleasure indeed to invite our President, Mr. Martin Broadhurst, to the stage to make the presentation. In doing so, I'm sure I speak for everyone here in welcoming Martin to the role of President of the Society, to which he acceded yesterday evening. It gets tougher, Martin, it gets tougher. Best wishes anyway, Martin, for an outstanding and an outstandingly enjoyable presidential year. The Geoffrey Pardo Space Award was first conferred in 1990. It commemorates Geoffrey Pardo, project manager for the Blue Streak ballistic missile program, 1956-60, later the director of the International Academy of Science and a past president of the Society. It's conferred for, and I quote, a significant contribution to space. The Geoffrey Pardo Space Award for 2014 goes to Mr. Richard Peckham, Business Development Director, Space with Airbus Defence and Space. Now, Mr. Peckham was recommended for this award by the Society's Medals and Awards Committee on the basis of his nomination by the Society's Space Specialist Group. He was at the same time recommended for the award of a Society Bronze Medal for his achievements. Now, both awards were approved last year by the Society's Council. The Bronze Medal was presented at the Wilbur and Orville Wright Annual Lecture and Dinner event on the 11th of December last. It's fitting that the Geoffrey Pardo Space Award should be presented here tonight at the Space Group Lecture. Now, Mr. Peckham receives his award in recognition of his leadership in the development and implementation of the UK's space innovation and growth strategy. He's been the driving force behind many of the initiatives in the UK space industry during the past decade, including the Case for Space, the 2010 Space Innovation and Growth Strategy, and the 2013 update to that strategy. His vision, his energy, and his leadership have ensured that the industry maintains a consistent and a forceful position in its dialogue with government on generating sustainable growth. Mr. Peckham, would you please come to the stage? There he is. The The Royal Aeronautical Society's Honours, Medals and Awards are the most prestigious and long-standing awards in global aerospace, honouring achievement, innovation and excellence. Our awards framework is inclusive, it's open to all, and it's highly competitive. The nominations that we receive genuinely reflect recognition by an individual or team's professional peers of significant achievements and contributions worthy of recognition by both the wider professional community and by, of course, our society in particular. We've been recognising excellence in this way for over 100 years, and in these respects, our honours, medals and awards continue to confer a unique measure of distinction. Now, we are currently considering the nominations we received for the 2015 round of honours, medals and awards, which are up some 36% in number against 2014, and 2014 nominations are up some 30% on 2013. So competition is becoming ever more exciting. The competition is already open for the 2016 round, which will coincide with celebrations of the Society's 150th anniversary. So, may I encourage you, how many of you nominated in this last round? Hands up, please. You need some encouragement, don't you? Okay. May I encourage you to consider offering your nominations for next year's round of Royal Aeronautical Society honours, medals and awards. Anyone can nominate. Anyone, any team that you feel deserves recognition by the Society for their contribution, achievement or service to the art and science of aeronautics and aerospace can be nominated. The deadline for receipt of nominations for the 2016 round is 31st of March 2016. Bags of time. Do it now nonetheless. Nomination forms are readily available on the Society's website. You should see a screenshot of that shortly. And you should find some hard copy versions on the table in the lobby as you leave. President, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the presentation of the Jeffrey Pardo Space Award for 2014. May I invite you, though, to offer a last round of applause for Mr. Richard Peckham and in honour of his achievements. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Steedon. So we now move on to the main event of the evening, which is the lecture by Jean-Jacques Dordain. When Jean-Jacques joined the European Space Agency in 1986, he was appointed head of the newly set up Department for the Promotion and Utilisation of the International Space Station. In 1993, he became Associate Director for Strategy Planning and International Policy. Then in 1999, he took the position of Director of Strategy and Technical Assessment. In 2001, he became Director of Launches, and then in July 2003, he was given the position of Director General. Since then, he's been reappointed to this position twice by the ESA Council. Quite an achievement. Before working at ESA, Mr. Dordain worked at the French National Office for Aerospace Studies and Research, ONERA, for 16 years. He has also held numerous professor teaching positions at academic institutions in France, Italy, Austria, and Belgium. So, Mr. Dordain, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and congratulations, Richard, for your award, but even more for your achievements. So thank you very much for inviting me to address 30 years at ESA, which means, if I have understood well, dedicating 2 minutes per year. And maybe this is the best way to characterize my 30 years at ESA. Time has been flying very fast. And I can report that my life has not been boring at all. But I have had the privilege to be at the right place at the right moment. And that, I must say that I would like to share that with you, because sometimes you can wonder if your career is something that which is predetermined. No, I just arrived at the right place at the right moment. I was starting as part of the space station program. And it was exactly at that time that we had the reunification between Space Station Freedom, the space station of the West, and of Mir 2, which was a space station of the East. So to be there, I can tell you, early 90s, to merge two space stations into one was certainly an interesting time. Then I was in charge of international relations when ESA has started concrete cooperation with Russia, with the two Euromir missions that I have negotiated myself, with Japan on the Artemis satellite, and with China with Double Star. And obviously, the program director was David, but I was in charge of the international relations. Then I was the director of strategy when ESA has started to cooperate with the European Union, another interesting time. I became director of launchers exactly when member states have decided to add to Ariane, Soyuz and Vega. I have signed the contracts as director of launcher to complete the range of launch capabilities. And I became director general when ESA has turned to become a world leading space agency, as well as a reliable vector of competitiveness and growth in Europe. And that are a lot of change on which I shall give you some more highlights. So after 30 years, ESA is not the same. This is not the same ESA that I have entered in 1986. And I am certainly not the one who has changed ESA. At least I am not by far the only one. But what I can tell you is that ESA has changed me. I am older today than its first change. But I have also gained a lot of experience about ESA, its partners, about ESA capabilities and also its constraints, and a lot about its past and therefore about its future. So instead of spending 2 minutes per year, I shall address 4 topics. More to stimulate questions and discussions than to just impose my views. And I keep a look on the clock. So the 4 topics will be 30 years of achievements and 30 years of change, first part. The second part will be the contribution from and to UK in these achievements and changes. The third topic will be on the recipes of success. And the fourth would be to address the future. Even though I shall not be part of the future of ESA, I think that the future is certainly the most interesting part, because this is certainly the part on which we could have discussions and questions. I think that it's too late to have questions on the past. So, 30 years of achievements and 30 years of change. So I shall not list all the achievements of ESA, which are much too many, and many more each year. When I arrived at ESA, we had 1-2 launch of a new mission per year. Today we are between 5 and 10, meaning that there is much more launches of new missions today than it could be at that time. And even more than the number of launches, the number of data, the number of scientific results, the number of services, the number of jobs created, in short, the value of what ESA missions are bringing down to Earth is growing every day. So I shall focus on the most noticeable changes which have occurred during the last 30 years, and I shall illustrate from time to time some changes by some pictures on the most famous achievements. So I have put the changes in two categories. Changes in the means that ESA is using, and changes in the results, it being understood that there is a close link between the means and the results, obviously. As far as the means are concerned, I have identified three main changes. The first one is the balance of activities. In 1986, we were still very close to ESRO and ELDO, meaning that the main task of ESA in 1986 were, let's put it, science, and even it was space science à la South Hood, space science and launchers. I would say science and infrastructure. This was the two main activities of ESA at that time. Science was focused in 1986 on the newly defined Horizon 2000, which was the starting point of something more European. On infrastructure, we were just after the decision on Ariane 5, Columbus. I would like to recall that at that time, part of the Polar platform, meaning what has become Envisat, was part of Columbus, which was justifying the contribution of UK to Columbus at that time. Hermes, data relay satellite, all that was a big infrastructure program decided in 85, 87. Applications were there, but not yet fully developed. We had obviously developed the first telecommunication satellites, but not yet fully fledged telecommunication services. We had already, we were already working on meteorology satellites, but we were at the very beginning of the meteorology satellite. And all that was just the starting point of applications program. I must say, today, the situation is very different. Science is representing 30% of the ESA total activities. Launchers and infrastructure, less than 30%. And applications and services are the most important part of the ESA activities, representing more than 40% of ESA activities. So it's a totally different type of distribution of activities. And more than that, science is not only anymore, by far, space science, science of space, but this is also a lot of Earth science, which was not there at that time, and also science in space with the use of the International Space Station, meaning that if science today represents 30% of the ESA activities, it's much more than the science which could be 30 years ago. On launchers, okay, there was some increase because of the decision taken last December 2014 with the development of Ariane 6 and Vega C, but it's not so much an increase. We are staying in the corridor because we have just completed the development of Soyuz and Vega, meaning that these developments are completed. And we are spending less money to support the exploitation. So the launcher is almost the same budget as in the last 25 years. And the in-orbit infrastructure is completed. And just to say that I was lucky to be there when the Columbus, at the end, was launched in February 2008. You know that during 20 years, the calendar of Columbus has not changed. It was always in 5 years. but at last we have launched it in 2008. But I recall that Columbus was twice that laboratory at that time when I arrived at ESA, and it was part of Space Station Freedom. And it was twice that size, because at that time the Space Station Freedom was on a 28-degree orbit. And when we have reunified the space station, we had to go to 51 degrees, meaning that the space shuttle could not have the same performance, meaning that we had to cut Columbus by two. And since I was a naive engineer still at that time, I thought that a shorter Columbus would cost less. I can report that it was not the case, meaning that I have got some experience. And more than Columbus, we have launched, industry has launched and produced one ATV per year. And we have just finished the story of ATV at the beginning of this year with the re-entry of the fifth one. And that it's a fantastic program, because to produce, this is the most complex vehicle that we have ever developed in Europe, because it's at the same time an upper stage of launcher, a satellite, a part of a manned infrastructure. So the complexity of ATV is very important, and it was a fantastic success. And the rendezvous and docking of the ATV with the space station is still unique. I remember that for ATV-4, we have made a docking without contact, because there is a docking in a cone, and the rendezvous was so precise that there was no contact with the cone. And I was told by the Russians that it was luck. But we have repeated that for ATV-5. So I told to the Russians, you see, it's not only luck. So ATV is a fantastic program. So we have completed the infrastructure, meaning that today the activities in infrastructure at ESA are not the biggest part of what we are doing at ESA. While applications and services have become the most important part of ESA activities, obviously, this is a domain of partnership. I shall come back to that, meaning that applications and services are not financed only by the member states. It is financed by the European Union. It is financed by private industry. It's financed by operators. But all in all, it means that applications and services represent between 40 and 45% of what we are doing at ESA. And this is telecommunications. Even though ESA is not delivering services anymore in terms of communication, the operators are doing that. But ESA is well involved in the telecommunications program, helping European industry and operators to be the best of the world. And we have succeeded. The telecom operators, the European telecom operators, are the biggest of the world. And that is a demonstration that what we can do together. Meteorology, we have the best meteorology satellite of the world also. We are at the third generation of Meteosat in geostationary orbit. We are at the second generation of the METOP satellite in polar orbit. And all that has contributed to to make of Europe the best in space-based meteorology. And when you know that 30% of the European economy is sensitive to weather forecast, be it for transport, agriculture, and so on, there is a lot of economic value behind the meteorology satellite. We are developing the Galileo constellation on behalf of the European Union. We are developing the Copernicus constellation, again, on behalf of the European Union. We have developed a lot the integration, the integrated applications promotion. We are at our ninth business incubator center in Europe. All that is applications and services, meaning that the volume of activities of ESA have doubled. And the Earth observation has become, and by far, the most important program of ESA in terms of budget. The Earth observation programs at ESA represent 1.3 billion per year. And meaning demonstrating the priority given by member states to Earth observation. And Earth observation is Earth science, and you have on this chart the gravitation field measured by the satellite GOCHE, which has just ended its mission last year. But GOCHE has provided a lot of information on the gravitation field and therefore on the ocean circulation. And you know that the influence of the ocean circulation on the climate, and especially the Gulf Stream, and the day we have not anymore the Gulf Stream, I think that all the Brits will be in the south of France. And and this is the reason why we are taking care of the Gulf Stream. But we are launching almost one satellite per year dedicated to Earth science. So here you have also information coming from the satellite SMOS, which is soil moisture and ocean salinity, which has also a strong influence on the climate. And on your right, CryoSat, which are looking at the ice. And we are the only ones in the world to measure the volume of ice, not the surface. Everybody is looking at the surface. But what we can do ourselves, it's from a satellite, we can measure the thickness of ice, which is the volume and therefore the mass. And there also, you know that the ice cover is melting at high speed. Meaning that with your science, we are looking at oceans, we are looking at land, we are looking at atmosphere, and we are looking at ice, the four elements of the climate. So this is just a demonstration that the activities at ESA are very different from what they were 30 years ago. Second big change, the membership of ESA. It can look a detail. But when I arrived at ESA, we were 11 member states. Today, we are 22, exactly twice the number of member states. And there is an acceleration in this new membership because we shall be 25, 28 in just a couple of years. And that has changed ESA. First of all, in the meeting rooms at ESA, we had to extend the tables. Meaning that now, since the Director General is at the end of the table, I am back on the wall. Meaning that next member state, I am through the wall. Or we have to make a mezzanine, so that I don't know how my successor will take that. But clearly, we had to change. Let's say now, headquarters of ESA is not anymore the house of the executive or the director general or the administration. This is the house of member states, which is good, because there is a spirit of property, or at least I hope so, from the member states. But that has changed also the decision-making process. As you know, we have one country, one vote. And while on the other hand, this is always a very few countries which are contributing to the budget. Let's say, with 11 member states or 22 member states, this is still two member states providing more than 50% of the budget, France and Germany. Still four member states, France, Germany, UK, and Italy, providing more than 75% of the budget. And six member states providing 85% of the budget. And that it's almost independent from the number of member states. Meaning that there is a reinforcement of the political hand by a number of member states. But on the other hand, it's clear that the big contributors are, have the impression that they are more and more isolated there, meaning that there is something to do on the decision-making process. And as a result of that, of this level of contribution, the industrial capacities in Europe are concentrated in six countries, while the services and the benefits are distributed on 30 countries. And that is a gap which is increasing between those who are providing the infrastructure and those who are benefiting from the services provided by this infrastructure. And this is, in my view, the best way to define the relationship between ESA and EU. ESA being the provider, ESA member states being the provider of infrastructure, and the EU being the user of this infrastructure. And this is on that basis that myself, I was the one to stimulate the relationship between ESA and EU. And we have more and more relationship between ESA and EU. But ESA and EU is to connect the space world with the world of citizens, the space world and the space infrastructure with the sectorial policies, policies for environment, policies for security, policies for agriculture, policies for development, and so on. So today, we are working, and you see that we are smiling when we are cooperating with the European Commission. So you see that it's a lot of smiles. And our cooperation is growing every day. Now, on the other hand, this is true that this type of cooperation is not easy because we are two different worlds. We are an agency driven by projects. They are an organization driven by regulations and policies, and meaning that we have to learn from each other. This is what we are doing. And this relationship is irreversible and must grow. But obviously, we have to make sure that this is for the good of the, all the citizens. And but we have much more partnership than with the European Union. We have more and more partnership with industry and operators, which is public-private partnership. Today, the telecommunications program of ESA is not anymore an ESA program. All telecommunications activities are made in the framework of public-private partnership. And I shall come back to that. The first one were developed with UK operators. But we have developed ILAS, we have developed AlphaSat, AG1, EDRS, Electra, NeoSat. All these public-private partnerships are driving the telecommunication program. And we are starting to do that in launchers. The decision on Ariane 6 is not just a new launcher, but this is a totally different way to develop launchers and exploit launchers in Europe, where the ESA member states and industry are sharing the objectives, the risk, not sure of the benefits that we shall see. We are also developing partnership with investors. As I said, the integrated application program is a program made in partnership with investors. The business incubation centers are centers created with investors. And we have more and more partnership with the international partners. In 30 years, we have moved from a junior partner of NASA, let's face it, to the most reliable partner of the world and of the world. Because now we are cooperating with Russia, we are cooperating with Japan, we are cooperating with China. And our role as a partner in the world is based on demonstration, not on words, not on books, but on demonstration. And we have celebrated 2 weeks ago the 25th anniversary of the Hubble Space Telescope. I can tell you that ESA was very visible in Washington, D.C. for this 25th anniversary. We were so good in the International Space Station with the ATV that now NASA has put ESA on the critical path of the development of their new crew transportation system. The service module of Orion will be provided by ESA. And ExoMars, we have succeeded on ExoMars to move in 1 year from a cooperation with the United States to a cooperation with Russia. And that is a demonstration of the reliability of ESA. Because if we were not reliable partners, we would not have done that. So this is all the change that I have identified. It means that is conducting, obviously, to change in results. First of all, the role of ESA is very different. We have moved from a customer-contractor relationship to a partner-to-partner relationship. And I can tell you it's much more comfortable to be in a customer-contractor relationship. It's much more comfortable for the two parties, for the customer and the contractor. Because when there is a success, you are the one. When there is a difficulty, the other is the one. So that is the relationship between customer and contractor. Much more difficult to be partner. Because you have to share the objectives. You have to share the calendar. And I see my colleague of Inmarsat making AlphaSat with Inmarsat is different from previous telecommunication satellites. So we have to share the resources, we have to share the risks, we have to share the difficulties. So it's much more difficult to be partner. But it pays off, meaning that the benefits are much bigger than when you are doing that on a just purely customer-contractor approach. And you share the benefits. So that is the first change in the relationship between ESA and its partners. The second change is the value of what we are doing at ESA. I have already mentioned that. We are now at ESA an enabler of economic growth. Because the economy is mostly with the applications and the services. The economy is not in space. So it does not mean that science and infrastructure are useless. That be careful on that. Because most of the applications and services are coming from an improvement in knowledge, an improvement in technology, in an improvement in competitiveness. Why? Because the competitor of space-based services is not so much the other space actors. The real competitor is a ground-based competition, meaning that to have space-based services, you have to demonstrate that it's much more competitive than the space-based solution. And this is the reason why science and infrastructure is still very important for applications and services and for the economy. But it's clear that today the driver of investments at ESA is economy. We have demonstrated, and I think that we have succeeded, to demonstrate that space is not an expense, it is an investment in the future. And that type of investment has diversified a lot the type of investment. And this is the reason why it's not anymore developing infrastructure, or at least not only developing new infrastructure. It's also using the data, developing the services based on technology and on data. And this is the raison d'être of the Integrated Application Promotion Program or of the Business Incubation Center. I shall be on Friday in Bavaria to open the 10th Business Incubation Center in Ottobrunn. And we have already created 3,000 jobs with this incubation, with these incubators. And we are creating 100 new companies every year with these business incubation centers. 87% of success. More than 20% of growth every year. It's more than the number of candidates to your prize. So, the last on economy and service and applications, this is the importance of education. The importance of educating people for the future economy, and space is a fantastic driver to attract the best people to science and technology, meaning that it's also a factor of economy. The third change is certainly the image of ESA, image in Europe, but also image in the world. And that, I must say, that the three most fantastic science missions that I have had myself during my mandate, and I have no credit for that. I am only, again, at the right place at the right moment. But we had Huygens, and this was the first time when we landed on Titan that we had the front page of all newspapers in the world. And that, as we have done that again with this image, which is fossil light after the Big Bang, what Planck has been able to provide has been on the front page, and I am collecting this front page of all newspapers in the world, including the Financial Times, by the way. And this is the reason why I have said, okay, when the finance is interested by the fossil light, it's good news. And we have done that again with Rosetta. I know that we have had some presentation of Rosetta, and I'm not the specialist of Rosetta. But Rosetta and Philae, we have been also on the front page of each of all newspapers. And even more than that, and this is true, when I landed in Orlando, Florida on the 3rd of December 2014, at the immigration, I was asked why a French was coming in Florida. So, and I said, I am coming to see the launch of Orion. And I was asked, but what are you doing? So I said, okay, I am working at the European Space Agency. I did not even say that I was director general. It was not useful. ESA. And he said, you are the one to have landed on a comet. So when someone at the immigration in Orlando, Florida, make the link between ESA and the comet, I can tell you that it's a different image. We have also a different image thanks to all the data that we are providing for climate change. We are by far the space agency in the world providing the maximum number of data related to climate change. And we shall feed the conference COP21, which will take place in December in Paris. We are also very well known with the, unfortunately, at each natural disasters, and we had a lot of pictures from Kathmandu in the recent weeks. And all that is a change, meaning that, I've already mentioned that we have the best meteorology satellites, we have the biggest telecom operators. All that has changed the image of ESA in the world. So I am coming to the contribution of UK now. Interesting. So UK, just to recall that UK was a founding member of ESRO and ELDO. It was the good old times where UK was part of the launches. And I am glad that Monsieur Pardoux was on the blue streak and therefore on Europa 2 as his name associated to your reward. So UK was founding member of ESRO and ELDO. UK has always been very important to ESA. And I said even once in front of the Science and Technology Committee of the House of Commons that ESA could not exist without UK. So just to say that I have said that officially and formally in front of a serious committee. It was on the 19th of March 2007. But I shall come back to that meeting because it was an important meeting. But the importance of UK has been fluctuating over the years, with ups and downs. And I shall just quote Jean-Marie Hutton, who was Director General in the 90s. He has written in 1995, and I can give you the book where it has been written. He has written, the UK has not a strong presence in ESA. In the first 20 years, it has focused on telecommunications and is now exclusively turning towards Earth observation. So it was not totally true, but it was not totally wrong either. When I remember, and Monsieur Southwood will remember, that even at the council at ministerial level 1995, the same year, UK was a driver in reducing the level of resource of ESA, and therefore the science program. That was the downs. So the presence of UK became more visible at the turn of the century, and mostly because Lord Sainsbury was the chair of the council at ministerial level at the end of the 90s, because he has chaired the council at ministerial level in 1999 in Brussels, meaning that the following one in 2001 took place in Edinburgh. And it was not yet a more significant presence in the programs, but a better presence in around the council table. So I think that the turning point took place in 2007. And I am coming back to this famous Science and Technology Committee of the House of Commons, which organized several sessions of space policy evidence. At least the word space policy evidence was not bad. So I was invited to the sixth session of the space policy evidence, and it was on the 19th of March 2007, and I was sitting next to David Southwood. And I shall always remember this session, during which I was calling UK an anomaly in ESA, and that I was saying that the only chance for UK to host an ESA center, because I'd been asked why no ESA center, was just for UK to become a big contributor, and that we could make a deal. UK becomes a big contributor, and we shall put an ESA center in UK. And that was a starting point, because all that was taken in the report. Just to say that the report, because I have looked back at the report yesterday. So the report, unfortunately, was issued on the 4th of July 2007, demonstrating the bias of UK, because you could have chosen the 14th of July, but okay. I am sure that you, on purpose, you have chosen the 4th of July. But the government response was issued on the 9th of October 2007, and the UK space strategy was issued by the end of 2007. Just to say that 2007 was, in my view, a turning point. And from that very moment, thanks to a collective effort in UK, because I think that it was a collective effort by all actors in UK, government, industry, operators, scientists, everybody has worked to make this strategy of the end of 2007 a reality, because a strategy is just a piece of paper. The most difficult part usually in a strategy is to translate the strategy into actions and into programs. That has been done. Meaning that the role of space in UK, as well as the role of UK at ESA, have dramatically changed since then. Materializing in several steps, the first one in the Council at Ministerial level 2008, next one, Council at Ministerial level in 2012, where UK has increased significantly its contribution to ESA. And what was good for ESA was not only the money of UK, not only the capacity of UK, but the ideas of UK. Because I can say, and I can repeat, and I am ready to repeat that even outside of London, that, and I have said that, and David knows that, David Parker, that UK has driven a lot of change at ESA. As I said, the first public-private partnership of ESA were invented here in UK, with the operator Avanti, and after that, the operator Inmarsat, and that was the starting point of the public-private partnership, making of UK the biggest contributor of the telecommunication program. But we got also the strong support of UK to start the integrated application promotion program. And this is thanks to UK that we could translate the good idea into actions, again, making it a reality and a success. UK has also taken the leadership of the climate change initiative. And in return, and this was a deal, we have built up Arwell. But Arwell is not just another center of ESA. This is a totally new type of center. And myself, and I have said that to the other member states, I would like to make of Arwell the pilot, the model of what should be ESA centers in the future. Because the ESA part of Arwell, because this is just a small part of Arwell, is open to the rest of the world. It's not a closed center. There is no walls around this center. This is a totally open center. And I am glad that we have been able to do that. And I am glad that the building will be inaugurated on the 9th of July. At least you have not chosen the 4th of July, so this is an improvement. And you see that on this picture that Roy Gibson has provided his name to this new ESA center. And I am glad of that because everything has started at ESA with Roy. So another part also of what UK has brought to ESA, this is the importance of space for education. UK has been the promoter of the A0 network for education. And I think that that is very important. I was reporting to the minister this afternoon that I have been invited to the Simon Langton Grammar School for Boys. As I was saying, it's called for boys, but there are girls. And I was there during the eclipse. I have spent one day in that grammar school, and this is one of my days. It was fantastic to talk and to see these children, because they were 16, 17 years old. But they are so enthusiastic about space, and that this is something that you should continue to cultivate. So we shall have the flight of team by the end of the year, and again linked to education. And even now, UK is back to launchers because you are developing new engines and for launchers, and meaning that there are so many actions in UK, which is making the difference between UK in space today and UK in space 30 years ago. I would like just to say thank you, UK, because you have brought a lot to ESA. I hope that ESA has brought to UK, but I think that UK has brought a lot to ESA. Meaning that ESA has changed, UK has changed. I have to hurry up. But the success is still there. And that is not so easy, because it's difficult to change when you are successful. And I can tell you that changing at ESA, because the old recipes have brought success, so why changing the recipes? Not easy to change when you are successful. Not easy to stay successful when you change. So to have ESA still being successful, in spite of the change of ESA, is something which is very important. And this is the reason why I've tried to identify the recipes of success. I shall go quick there, because it's only recipes. But last year, we have celebrated 50 years of cooperation and innovation at ESA. And this is the two first recipe. It's cooperation and innovation. Cooperation, because we could not do, let's say, any individual member state, including the French, they could not do without the cooperation at ESA. So the cooperation at ESA is at the heart of the success of ESA. Not easy to cooperate. I can tell you, each time I have a council meeting, I measure the difficulty to cooperate. So it's not easy to cooperate. But, and it's even slower, because to take decisions at 22, okay, you need a little bit more time. But it's necessary, and this is much more sustainable. And so cooperation is the first recipe. The second one is innovation. We are innovating every day. We are inventing the future at ESA. Not only in ESA, we are inventing the future with our partners, but we are inventing the future. I always told to ESOC, my colleagues of ESOC, you have to invent the operations of 10 years from now, not the routine operations that everybody can do that. But we have to invent. And it's not only technology. And obviously, to innovate, you have to take risks. And that, this is the difficult part of innovation. Everybody wants to innovate. But when you say that to innovate, you have to take risks, more difficult, especially in a government organization. But we have to take risks. Making Rosetta was very risky. Rosetta was invented 30 years ago. And it was risky to land on, to have the idea to land on a comet. And but we made it. And the only way to reconcile success and risk, and that I have said that many times, is expertise. Expertise is the only way to reconcile risk and success. And expertise is not only technical there also. The expertise is human. And that I am saying that to all the young people and the students. Expertise is not only mathematics, science, engineering, but it's also human because of the cooperation. You cannot cooperate with someone that you don't understand. That is the expertise. Meaning that at the end, the recipes are only recipes. But as you know, in the cook, this is not the recipes which are important. This is the chef. Meaning that at the end, the important part of the recipe of the success is the people. The people of ESA, the people of industry, the people of scientific community, the people of the research centers, every people. But the people is the most important part. The people are becoming old. Look at me. Meaning that we have to sustain this this expertise, this human expertise. We are working with several generations. And a significant part of the cooperation is between the young guys and the experienced guys. Because this is that cooperation which improves the expertise. And this successive generation is very important. This is what I say. I am meeting twice a year the newcomers of ESA. I am asked to welcome them at ESA. And I am always, since 12 years, meaning that I have said that 24 times, I am always concluding my speech by saying, don't let ESA change you. You, the newcomers, you have to change ESA. And this is true for my successor. I hope that ESA will not change him, that he will change ESA. Because the people is very important. So thanks to all that, ESA is synonym of success. Not so much in spite of the change, but thanks to the change. Because ESA could not stay successful if ESA had not changed. Meaning that ESA has to continue and change. And this is, okay, I shall be short on the future, unfortunately. Just one word on the future. The future will be made of more changes. I am sure, including the change of people, starting with the Director General. So we have to prepare the changes of the future. Obviously, one of the drivers in the future will certainly stay the economy, the competitiveness, the growth. That I am sure that it will stay as a driver in all what we are doing at ESA. But this will not be enough. Because this is the future of planet Earth which is at stake, and even the life on planet Earth which is at stake, and where space and ESA must take a growing importance. Meaning that the economy driver is for the short term, because that is the short term. We have to create competitiveness and jobs, and that this is in the short term. Nobody is interested by the jobs in 10 years from now. While the other driver, which is the future of planet Earth and the future on planet Earth, is for the longer term, even though actions have to be taken in the short term. So that is the result of the two main messages that space has brought to planet Earth. The first message coming from space is that planet Earth is one. And that this is the heritage of Apollo. I have said that many times in Washington. The heritage of Apollo is not anymore by far the fact that this is a US flag which was the first on the moon. It's totally irrelevant to the current world. What stays from Apollo is Apollo 8, Christmas 1968, first time that a crew was escaping the gravity of Earth, turning around the moon. And Bill Anders was saying, we have made all this way to explore the moon, but the most important thing is that we discover planet Earth. Because they are the three first men in the history having seen the planet Earth as a ball of golf. This is the way, Monsieur Anders, I have not seen that, seen pictures. But as a small ball of golf, saying that the future on planet Earth is collective, because planet Earth is one. And the second message is that planet Earth is unique. There is no alternative to planet Earth. The first planet is not yet at reach. So we have no alternative but to continue to live on planet Earth. So the fact that planet Earth is one and planet Earth is unique is two messages coming from space, and that we have to take into account to invent the future of space and the role of space in the future. So that is certainly something that we have to integrate more in what we are doing. This concerns obviously environment and climate change, and that we are already making a lot on that. But it's also management of resources, especially the expendable resources, and maybe bring some additional resources. But this is also international cooperation. I always insist on that. Space is a model of cooperation. And space has always been a forerunner of the cooperation. We were still in the middle of the Cold War when Apollo Soyuz took place in 1975. The first reunification that we have done was in space with the International Space Station. And I hope that the next one will be the reunification between the International Space Station and the Chinese Space Station. Because international cooperation in space is a driver of cooperation on ground. Six astronauts today on board the International Space Station, 6,000 people working together on three continents to make them safely living and working in the space station. Meaning that, and I have said that, especially with the current problems with Russia, that we should not export the problem of planet Earth to space. On the contrary, we have to import from space the model of cooperation. And the last part is the role of education. I am convinced that space is a fantastic driver to attract, to motivate young generations. And that is also something that we have to integrate fully in what we should do at ESA. So still so many things to do at ESA. I am sure that the director generals are passing, ESA is staying, and so many things to do at ESA. My successor will not have a boring life, I can guarantee that. And new people, they have to bring new ideas, new change at ESA. And this is what I wish for ESA. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dordain, for a fantastic insight into 30 years of ESA. We have time for about 20 minutes of questions and answers, so could I ask you to please say who you are when you ask your questions, and please be brief with the questions, no sort of 10-minute questions.
Well,
you
can be long on the question and brief on the answers, but it's up to you.
So we have two roving microphones, so if people could show their hands if they have a question to ask. I have one here.
Hi, Alex Wood from CGI. In your 30 years at ESA, what would you say has been the most difficult challenge you faced?
Every day. no, ESA is difficult. I shall not say that it's easy to work at ESA. And I am not just speaking of the Director General. There are several difficulties. There is a difficulty of cooperation. As I said, it's always easier not to cooperate. There is a difficulty of a multicultural environment. I can tell you, 21 nationalities at ESA. It's an interesting bunch of people. Very rich, I must say. I have learned so much at ESA that I am not ready to go back to a Franco-French system. I can tell you that no way. I am not criticizing that. But it's difficult. It's difficult to work with Italians, Swedish, English, and and there is the difficulty of making the best missions of the world also. Making Rosetta, making La Facette, making science missions, launching. A launch is never a routine event. And especially myself, I know all the reasons to have a failure. So all that is difficult. But this is so interesting that I can tell you that I am sad to leave ESA. I am not glad to leave ESA. Okay, it's a fact. I am not complaining by far. But no, I shall regret the difficulties of ESA. But yes, it's every day difficult. But it's such a reward. And especially the number of emotions that I have had. The day Rosetta has woken up, the day we have made this rendezvous with the comet, the day we have landed on the comet. I shall never exchange that against any fortune that I can tell you. That. So in front of the difficulties, you have the reward. You have the reward to learn from your colleagues, because I have learned a lot and I am learning every day. You have the reward of success, and you have the reward of motion. So I am glad that I have spent 30 years at ESA.
Question at the back there, and then one over there.
Hello, Simon Kaufman from AACOM. Very impressive to see how ESA pioneered public-private partnerships in the past with major industry. I'm very interested to know where you think ESA will go in the future with the emerging sort of privatization of space in terms of the many smaller businesses like Excor, Virgin, what have you, that are doing things with private industry, and also the flourishing number of flourishing discussion of spaceports that's taking place right across the European Union.
Of space, I have not...
Spaceports.
Ah, spaceports, yes. I must say that there is not one model of privatization or commercialization. There are so many words to cover so many different things. Because I cannot compare, for example, the what SpaceX is doing on launchers, because, okay, let's take that example. SpaceX is a fantastic enterprise, but this is based on two pillars. The first pillar is to have a market coming from the government. Say, NASA is purchasing 4 to 5 launchers a year. And number two, the second pillar is to develop a new launcher from scratch. Because thanks to Atlas and Delta, SpaceX could build up a totally new enterprise. Okay, we have not that at in Europe. We have not the public market of that size, and we cannot develop a new launcher in parallel. We cannot develop Ariane 6 as from scratch. We have to develop Ariane 6 in the continuity of Ariane 5, because we cannot. We have not the means to continue Ariane 5 and to develop a totally new Ariane 6. So that is one type of, I don't know if we call that privatization, because this is a private enterprise, but based on public market and based on the fact that there are other players in the United States giving the possibility to SpaceX to develop a launcher from scratch. So that is one type of privatization. There is other privatization where you have private investors putting their money on new projects because they hope that there will be a market. So the market does not exist. So they are taking a risk in that case. That it's totally different. It's another model. Ourselves, we have tried to have to develop some models according to our situation and our constraints. Just to recall that Europe has been the first one to create an operator for launch services. Arianespace is the first ever model of operator. Okay, which was not bad. I have spoken of public-private partnership in telecommunications, but no one looks like another one. I cannot compare ILAS, AlphaSat, AG1, and EES. They are all specific. We have not one model of public-private partnership. Maybe the only relationship between these different public-private partnership is the fact that we are sharing the risks. We ESA, meaning the member states, they are taking the risks to invest in new technologies. And the private operator is taking the risk to use these new technologies to open a new market. We are not providing any market to our private partner. We are just providing technology for free. He takes the risk to qualify it in orbit and to use it to open a new market. Okay, that is the basis on which we are developing the public-private partnership. But each one is very specific. And this is the reason why it takes some time, unfortunately. And this is one of the problems which we have maybe to improve. This is the time to market. We are still spending much too much time to take decisions, including in public-private partnership. But that's okay. There is always room for improvement. But so yes, the world is changing. By the way, in the United States, a significant part of the investors are not space investors. This is investors coming from the internet. Investing in space because they hope that space could bring them an added value. Okay, we have no Google in Europe. We have more Amazon. But okay, does not mean that there is no idea. And I am confident that we can develop initiatives in Europe.
Can you?
Next question. I think there was a question.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Can you confirm that the juice project will go ahead and where will it go exactly? The juice project.
The juice project?
Yes.
Oh, we are evaluating the industrial proposals for the timing. I have been told that the technical assessment will be over by 15th of June, and that I hope that we shall have the assessment of the industrial proposals by the end of June, beginning of July. So JUICE is a project which has been approved by the scientific program committee. So again, we are now evaluating the industrial proposals. There is still some steps to cross before we enter into the development phase. But okay, JUICE is part of our horizon in the science program.
Any decisions made on which moons to investigate?
For the time being, I have understood that this is Ganymede. I am not a scientist myself. I can tell you that I would prefer Europe because I hate that NASA would be the first landing in Europe. and I have said that way to Charlie Bolden. I always told him I shall not let you going to Europe alone. But I am not a scientist, so this is a characteristic of the science program. This is a program which is driven by scientists, not by the director general. The director general is giving to the scientists how much it costs and how long it will take. The member states are giving a level of resource, but the scientists, they decide.
So the finance is in place.
We have a level of resource. We have a level of resource which is 500 million per year, something like that, provided by the member states. And within this yearly level of resource, we have to implement a plan which includes what we call the. At least it was called Cornerstone, but now it's large mission. Let's say 1 billion. Meaning 2 years of budget, medium mission, which are 500 million, 1 year of budget, and small missions, which are 100 million around. So this is to the scientists to see how they wish to plan these large, medium, and small missions according to their priority. So this is, but clearly the scientists are the drivers. The director general of ESA has never dared to go against the scientists. It's much too dangerous. So, so they are the masters, and JUICE has been defined by them. Now, what we shall tell them now is that it will cost that amount. It will take that number of years. Now, do you confirm or not that this is the mission that you wish to make? It being understood that the scientists, they have always more ideas than we have money. That this is, which is good, because the day they have less ideas than we have money, that I should be scared.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. I think the next question was from Mr. Amos from the BBC there.
Hello, Jean-Jacques. Yeah, I want to take you back to 2009 and the appointment of the new intake of astronauts. And we were sitting in that room in Paris, ESA HQ, and in fact, we were both at the end of the table that day. And after the astronauts were introduced, asked for questions from the media, and because I was sitting there at the end of the table, I got to ask the first question. And I said, thank you, Director General, for giving us an astronaut, but why? Because at that stage, the UK did not contribute anything to the International Space Station program. And there was a lot of nodding in the room. There was a lot of agreement from everyone else, from other countries. And so there's obviously quite a bit of resistance to that appointment. So what I want to know is, how difficult was that appointment to make Tim a member of the Corps? And also, was it a calculated decision? Were you making that decision thinking about or helping the UK come back into the fold in a bigger way to ESA?
Okay, first of all, yes, I can confirm that there was a lot of resistance, in particular in some member states, that I dared to select someone from UK as an astronaut. That it's so you are right. Number two, and I said that in the House of Commons, I think that I have done my best not to select Tim Peake, but he was so good that I could not do differently, because he was good, very good. But these astronauts, just to recall how I have selected, because I am the one who have taken the selection, because there were 8,000 candidates for 4 positions. And I shall all. I think that since you are following me since long, you remember that I was saying the same year I have opened 4 positions of astronaut, and I got 8,000 candidates, and 4 positions of directors, and I got 80 candidates. Meaning that it's 100 times more interesting to be astronaut than to be director. I have not interviewed, obviously, the 8,000 candidates, so there was a long process, 1 year. It took 1 year. But myself, I have been given the top 10. And the top 10, I have interviewed them myself. Because the astronauts are very important for the image of ESA. And I must say that the 10 were very, very good, that starting point. But after that, I had to rank them. So I shall not give you the ranking, because I have never disclosed that. But they were so good that I have selected 6 instead of 4, just because it was too difficult to restrict to 4. So I have selected 6, and Tim Peake was obvious in that top 6, so I had no difficulty to select him, and that this is the main reason for Tim Peake to be part, because it is a very good guy, and so I have overcome the resistance, but that I have some experience on that, now was it calcul. Maybe I trust UK more than you do. and I was convinced by selecting Tim Peake I would raise some interest in UK. That I was convinced of that, because Tim Peake was so good, and that his flight would be so so important, that I was confident that that could lead to some contribution of UK to ISS, and that was done at the ministerial 2012. And I shall always remember, I think, that David Parker, or the negotiations with Minister Villette during that night were interesting. And you remember that in my press conference after the ministerial, I said I shall make my press conference in English as a reward to UK to be part of the space station. So that it's. But I am so glad that Tim Peake will fly. This year we shall have 3 astronauts on board the space station. We have Samantha, Christopher Etty, who has an extended mission. After that, we shall have Monsieur Mongelsen, and then Tim Peake. Meaning that the 6 which have been selected in 2009, I promised them that they will fly before 2020. And they will all have flown by 2017. That is a demonstration also that the ESA astronauts are very well considered by the partners, saying that ESA is the most reliable partner. That it's another demonstration of the quality of the ESA staff, including the astronauts. But Tim Peake is a fantastic guy, so I could not do without Tim Peake.
Okay, I think we've got time for a couple of questions. I'm actually going to ask a question myself, Mr. Dordain, if I may. And it's a question about the sustainability of the space environment, which is something you didn't mention in the talk. So, obviously, we're all aware with the increasing problem of space debris that the space environment itself is threatened in the long term. So we know ESA is doing various activities under the Clean Space heading, but do you think ESA is doing enough, and could ESA be doing more of pushing the member states more to help clean up space?
You are never doing enough. That I and I have said in the last agenda, because I have written an agenda at each of my mandate. I have written agenda 2007 for my first mandate, agenda 2011 for the second mandate, and agenda 2015. And in the agenda 2015, there is the concept of clean space, meaning that clean space, which is across all the programs of ESA, is something that we are taking care of. And I wish to have ESA, and the member states have supported me on that, to have ESA being a model agency in that context. But on the other hand, let's face it, this initiative of clean space is against the competitiveness of European satellites and European launchers. And if you are the only one, you have to balance what you are doing good for the cleanliness of space and what you are doing bad for the European sector. Just to say that myself, I have decided, and I have been supported by the member states, to make METOP second generation, the satellites of METOP second generation, being able to make a controlled re-entry. But with that, two-thirds of the fuel which is embarked on METOP is for the re-entry, meaning that it's a much bigger satellite, a much more expensive satellite, just to make sure that we can make a controlled re-entry with METOP. But if we are the only ones in the world to make that, we are making, let's say, I am making something good for the future generations. And the motto of the clean space is to say to give to our children the same space that we have inherited ourselves, which is a space without anything not operational. But to do that, you may hurt the European sector. So this is something on which we believe, on which we are taking a lot of initiatives, but we should be totally stupid to be the only ones. And that this is not only the Director General of ESA, but this is much more, much above the head of the Director General of ESA. So I wish to make of ESA a model agency for that. But first of all, ESA is not the one who is launching the biggest number of satellites. There is much more satellites coming from other partners than from us. And number two, if we are alone, we are making something bad for the competitiveness of the European sector. So we have to balance that.
Okay. Final couple of questions. We've got one on here. And then one over here.
Good afternoon. My name is Michael Cooper. In your experience, do you think the International Space Exploration Coordination Group will become something as well integrated as the European Space Agency?
It's a coordination group, meaning that it's already a forum where we have 14 space agencies together, something like that. For me, the most important part of this coordination group is that the Chinese are there. Because myself, I am convinced that we cannot isolate the Chinese. For what concerns exploration, I am not, I am not a politician and so on. But for what concerns the future of space exploration, including in low Earth orbit, and I was mentioning the space station, I think that we have to make sure that the Chinese will be with us. So. So I am glad that the coordination group is working and involving again Chinese and the Korean, I think. But this is only a coordination group, and they are making reports. So what's next? Because we can make reports for another 100 years. And this is what I say, and especially in front of the young generation. Myself, I am coming from a generation which is fantastic. And myself, Sputnik, 3 years later Gagarin, 7 years later Armstrong. There was such an acceleration that I could only work for space because it was a fantastic project at reach in terms of calendar. What I regret in the this international exploration program is that the calendar is moving always by 1 year every year, and I have even made speeches in United States to say, you, United States, you have to take concrete initiatives because including in United States, they have moved from the moon to Mars to asteroids and so on, but that it's only plans. I think that we need to have much more than plans. And this is the reason why I think that this coordination group should just set common objectives, but leave each partner to do what they want. Because if everybody is waiting for his neighbor, we have always good reasons not to do anything, and we have to do. I am myself for short-term projects, and who is interested by an objective in 2040. At least myself, I am not interested because I know where I shall be. So, so we need to make the future much closer to the present than to have only plans which are again moving by 1 year every year. So it's a good coordination group. I appreciate that, and ESA is contributing as much as we can. But it should go now beyond just coordination. It should go to individual projects. And that is, and I am taking the example of ESA. This is what I say to my international partners. The 22 member states of ESA, they are just sharing the same broad objectives. But after that, two or three of them, they can start a project through optional programs. They have not to wait for the 22. To be ready to go somewhere. If three, four of them are ready to go somewhere without the others, they can do at ESA. The flexibility of ESA is fantastic. And this is the way myself I see the global cooperation is not to have global projects because that will be much too slow and much too difficult, but to have common objectives, to have the same type of platform, to have a platform of exchange, but provided each partner can, within these shared objectives and this common platform, to make their own project. And what they should share is the transportation, because the transportation are just the trucks. Nobody is interested to transport kilos to Mars or to transport kilos to the moon. So we should share the transportation, because the value of these missions is on Mars, is on the moon, is on asteroids, but not on the trucks. So I am telling to the partners, we have to share the trucks. But okay, it will take some time.
Okay, thanks. I think we're running out of time, so I think we'll just have one more very short question, hopefully with a very short answer, Mr. Dordain.
The answer is no.
Hi, Katrina Boyd, working in the defence sector. Possibly fairly quick, it's going to be a boring question, but what would be the effect on ESA and on the UK if the UK did leave the EU? Sorry.
Okay, that is a very difficult question. And as I said, UK is a very important member of ESA, and ESA is working very closely to the EU. So I am sure that we would miss an important representative around the table of the EU, because we need that. The best way to have a good cooperation between ESA and EU is to have the same member states having the same position on the two places. And that I have again repeated that to the new UK minister. So I would miss, ESA would miss an important representative around the table of the EU when space is at stake. But again, I don't want to enter into a wider debate on that.
Okay, thanks. I think we'll draw the
because
meeting.
Because I still wish to come to London.
You'll always be welcome in London, Mr. Dordain. So I think we need to draw the meeting to a close. Before we thank Mr. Dordain again for such a fantastic insight into the European Space Agency, I'd like to just present him with a small gift from the Society, and then I'll ask you all to thank him again for his talk. So if you haven't need to wear ties after you've retired, then this is a Royal Aeronautical Society tie. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.